You're watching Nortuning. On this episode, we will do some modifications to the pistons and install them. At the end of this clip, I will show you some footage of the last track day I did with my old engine. And it was already on its last legs, but nevertheless, I had a lot of fun and it got me home afterwards. Enjoy. Before we install the pistons, let's look at some old pistons. This is the piston from the engine I'm rebuilding right now, and although it looks okay, the top ring groove is too wide, it is out of spec, so I can't use this piston. This is half a piston. It's from an engine which had a catastrophic failure. On one piston, the aluminium was blown away and it had no compression. And all the other pistons had also the top ring groove was too wide and out of spec. So also couldn't be used again. This is the piston from my old track day car engine. It was rattling for a long time. I didn't know what caused it, but when I took it apart, I saw that the top ring groove was much too wide. The piston ring broke and it was so wide they were able to stack up within the piston ring groove. So the top ring groove seems to be the weak point of this engine, and now the question is, what caused it and what can we do to prevent this from happening? I went to my local machine shop to ask if they knew what could cause this problem, and they said it was due to high revving the engine. Well, this was a torquey engine and I didn't rev it very high. I always shifted at 6000 RPM and sometimes 6500 RPM. And also the second ring does the same RPM and there is no problem. So this probably isn't the whole story. So what is the whole story? You always have to do your own research, and to do some research, this is a perfect book. This covers all you want to know about performance tuning, and it's by Graham Bell. This is the normal situation. Here is the cylinder pressure. It acts on the back of the ring, pushing the ring towards the bore and making a perfect seal. Now at high RPM, what can happen is the piston starts to go down, the piston ring loses contact from the underside, seals off the pressure so it doesn't get pushed against the bore anymore, and the pressure can escape between the ring and the bore. One big problem here is that although the main task of the top ring is to seal the cylinder pressure, the second task is to dissipate the heat from the piston to the bore to the water jacket. In this case, this is possible. The heat can dissipate to the water jacket. In this case, there isn't any contact between the bore and the ring, so the piston gets hotter, and when it gets hotter, the aluminium gets softer and there is more chance that your top ring groove will distort. So now we know what the problem is, what can we do about it? Well, the first thing we can do about it is make sure that the piston ring gap of the second piston ring is bigger or similar to the piston ring gap of the first piston ring, so there can't be any buildup of pressure between the piston rings. The second thing you can do is make a V-shaped gas balancing groove between the top and the second ring. This will increase the volume between the rings and therefore the pressure rise will be more slowly, will be slowed down. The third thing you can do is make lateral gas ports. This will ensure that the pressure of the cylinder has a chance of getting behind the piston ring. Here it's blocked, and when you have a lateral gas port, the pressure is able to get behind the piston ring and restore the normal operation. Here you see it in a David Weisart book and the Goodson tool he used. And here you see my piston, the V-groove and the lateral gas ports. Here you see the work in progress. I made 8 lateral gas ports. When I later read the book again, I saw that Graham Bell advises 6 lateral gas ports up to 83 millimeter bore diameter. But I had already bored 8, so. This is the tool I made. I used a 2 millimeter drill, and this support makes sure that the drill cuts half its diameter into the piston. It will clamp down on the piston so the tool won't rotate, because the drill cuts only half in the piston, it will want to rotate the tool. Also, on the drill, I made a support that you can cut to the exact depth of the piston ring groove. The next step is to fit a piston ring. Push down the piston ring slot in the piston ring groove and rotate it so you are sure it can rotate freely, and would there be a burr in the lateral gas port, you will cut down on the burr. The next step is to polish the top of the piston. The only reason for this is to make it harder for the suit to stick to the top of the piston. First, I will take down the sharp edges with a 400 grit emery cloth, and then sand the top of the piston with a 1000 grit emery cloth, and finally polish it on a polish wheel. Here you can see the piston just after taking down the sharp edges with a 400 grit. Now for the piston rings. The ring gap of the second piston ring was a little bit smaller than the ring gap of the first piston ring. So I had to cut off 500th millimeter of the second piston ring. To do this, I made a tool, because by hand it's very hard to cut exactly 500th of a mil of a piston ring. And this tool works perfectly. Just set a dial to close to zero, then start the tool, and when you hear it touching, look at the gauge, what the number is, and grind up 500th of a mil. Here I'm placing the oil control ring. These are 3-piece Hastings oil control rings. The installation is a bit different than the standard oil control ring. As you can see, you first have to install the spacer. Then you can spiral down top steel rail, and finally you can spiral down the bottom steel rail. You can't use the expander tool on these steel rails. And according to my machine shop, they should do a very good job of controlling the oil consumption. Here is the piston complete with the rings. Note that I also drilled some oil drain holes that break out beneath the bottom oil rail to improve oil control. This is the tool I'm using to install the pistons. It's just an old piston liner. I made a taper in it, so when you push down the pistons, the piston rings will get compressed. I made a 45 angle sharp ridge on it, which will fit in the chamfered edge of the bores. I also made a cut down the liner. This will, there's some tension in the liner, so when you cut it, it will shrink a bit and the diameter will get a little bit smaller. The downside of this was that my new pistons weren't going down smoothly, so I had to resolve to tapping it down in the cylinder bore because there was some friction. Here I have some engine oil, 10W40, and oiling up the cylinder liner. Placing the piston installation tool. Dipping the piston in the engine oil to lubricate the piston rings. Check if all the piston rings are fitted correctly and then push down the piston. Here I had to use some tapping to push down the piston some more. Watch if the noise, the pitch of the tapping stays the same. If the pitch gets higher, the piston gets stuck, or some piston ring will block. Support the big end, so with the falls onto the big end journal of the crank. Here I place that plastic gauge. Here we check the bearing clearances. It's somewhere between 0.04 and 0.05 of a millimeter. Then loop up the journals and the bearings with some assembly loop. Tighten the big end caps to the specified torque. Here you can see I use some feeler gauges to pick up the slack between the big end so you don't put any force on the bearing surfaces. So the pistons are in, and now some footage of the last track day I did with my old engine. Let's see how an Alfa engine performs with one top piston ring completely broken. Enjoy.